All right, let's move on to the final team presentation, NONA Technologies. The presenter is Mr. Bruce Crawford. Please welcome him with a warm round of applause.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. We are honored to be here. We're nearing the end of the meeting. I want to give everyone permission to stretch. Stand up if you want to. I'll take a minute to do the same. Get comfortable. We're almost done. My name is Bruce Crawford. I'm joining you from MIT with my partner, Dr. Jung-Hyo Yoon. We are launching a startup from MIT with a new water technology solution that has the potential to address the global water shortage. This is a picture from 2017 after Hurricane Maria struck the island of Puerto Rico. This disaster, like many hurricanes, flattened structures. It crippled infrastructure. The power was out, and many were left without clean water. About 3,000 people perished as a result of this disaster, many because of the polluted water that they were drinking. The situation was so dire that a third of the population, over a million people, were left without clean water for months after the disaster. Some resorted to knowingly drinking from wells that were known to be polluted, with sewage, with dead animals, other gross stuff. The normal response after a disaster like this, and unfortunately there is a normal response because these disasters are becoming more common, is to send bottled water. The United States responded by sending thousands and thousands of pallets of plastic water bottles after this disaster, many of which were placed on this airstrip. Now, let me take a moment. Many of you have plastic water bottles like this one. What many people don't know about plastic water bottles like these is they have a shelf life of about 1 year. And that shelf life gets a lot shorter if they're exposed to heat or UV light. And you see where this is going. Unfortunately, there's a lot of heat and UV light on a Puerto Rican airstrip. When people received water from this source, they reported that it tasted bad and it smelled bad. In many cases, they returned it. Afterwards, more than 16 million water bottles were found dumped in fields around Puerto Rico. A few pictures. This was a bad response to a climate disaster that made things worse and did not help anyone. Now, an interesting thing about the global water shortage is it can impact people in so many different ways. Some people may be thrust into water scarcity by a disaster like this. Some people may live with it every day. Some of us, like I suspect most of us in this room, we don't feel water shortage today, but nevertheless, it's a growing problem. It's descending upon us, but we have the power to act. And if we act now using technology and innovation, we have a chance to make a better future. Today, this is the current state. About 1 in 3 people lack reliable access to clean water. And unfortunately, that number is growing. Experts predict that by the end of the decade, there will be a 40% gap on Earth between water supply and water demand. This may be the first major way that many of us experience climate change. Indeed, it's hard to think of a bigger problem for our species right now than water shortage. Myself, am from the United States. We're feeling water shortage there. I have lived in California and seen droughts that afflict Southern California. I've also lived in Florida, where I remember my family piling into a minivan and fleeing a Category 4 hurricane when I was a child. I think that I have a unique perspective on water shortage and the problem that it is and will become. Fortunately, my partner, Dr. Jung-Hyo Yoon, is a leading expert and what I think could be the solution. Dr. Yoon is an MIT research scientist in the Research Laboratory for Electronics. He's also a PhD from Korea University. Dr. Yoon's been spending the last several years developing a new technology, which we think can make a difference for people suffering water shortage. We also happen to be friends and neighbors. Here's a picture of us getting barbecued together. We met watching our daughters play. We have daughters about the same age. And we live in the same building, so they played together. One day we were talking, and Dr. Yoon shared what he was working on. And I was very interested, because I've seen some water shortage issues. I know what a big problem it is. I also have seen the power of technology to make a difference in these climate-related matters. I was part of the product development team at an electric car company in America that made the world's first electric pickup truck. So I believe that we could do something similar with this water shortage issue. Engineering and technology can make a difference. So, the technology. Before I dive into exactly what Dr. Yoon developed, let me give you some context on water purification. So water purification generally is any process that removes contaminants and impurities from water. But only a very extreme type of purification, called desalination, can remove the salt in addition to the impurities. And what an amazing thing to do. Over 70% of the Earth's surface is covered in water. There's a lot of water underground, too, and most of that water is salty. In fact, of all the water that's available to us on Earth, less than 1% is both fresh, meaning not salty, and liquid. So desalination is a great solution, and it's been around a long time, and yet still 1 in 3 people today lack reliable access to water, and it's getting worse, as we covered. The original way to do desalination is evaporation or distillation. This is where you heat water till it turns to steam and then condense that steam. It's very energy intensive to do that. The way that almost all desalination is done today is reverse osmosis. This is the state of the art, invented in the 1970s. Reverse osmosis is more efficient than evaporation, but it still has some drawbacks. At the small scale, it's not very efficient because it takes super high pressure. It's basically a filtration process where you push water through a filter with pores small enough for only water molecules to fit through. The pressure required to do that is about 800 psi, which is like 13 times the pressure in your car or your bicycle tires. So pretty energy intensive. These filters, just like any filter, they clog, they need to be replaced. There's a lot of chemicals involved in this system to keep the water clean, keep the membranes clean, so they have to be changed less often. For these reasons I've described, desalination generally looks like this. Huge plants. And these plants are very expensive. Billions of dollars, in this case. So that really limits the kinds of places that the plants can exist. They have to be near a large, wealthy population and a place with the political will to build something like this. In my former home state of California, for example, there's a lot of people, there's wealth, there's drought, and yet politicians routinely vote down the building of plants like this. It's a real problem. And that's just in addition to the technical factors that I mentioned. The solution to us is a new type of desalination, which works anywhere, at any scale. Could be big, could be small. We are commercializing a solution that is compact, less than 10 kilograms, smaller and lighter than 1 case of water bottles. It's reliable. It never needs a membrane or a filter replacement. It is efficient enough to support a family of 10 people with one small portable solar panel. And it's simple. It's as easy to use as a microwave and doesn't require any chemicals. Imagine if a solution like this had been deployed after Hurricane Maria in Puerto Rico. Instead of shipping a huge pallet of water bottles, which could support one family for 1 month in the best case, a family could be issued a NONA device, which could provide water for them indefinitely with no risk of expiration. And it works when the power's off, totally off grid. So how does it work? Why can we make a device like this when current technologies, current competitors cannot? It's because of this technology that Dr. Yoon developed. Invented at MIT, we are using a multi-phase electromembrane process. It's called ion concentration polarization. I'll refer to it as ICP. And put very simply, it's an electromagnet pulling salt and bacteria from water with electrical attraction. Because we're using this process, we never have to push water through a filter. We don't have to heat the water up. We work at super low pressure. Our device, which can provide enough water for a family, uses less power than your laptop charger. I personally am amazed at the beautiful simplicity of the solution, and I'm very excited about the possibilities that it unlocks. Dr. Yoon, interestingly, did not set out to create a new solution for the water shortage. Dr. Yoon was working with this technology to concentrate samples of viruses and bacteria to test for them more efficiently. He noticed in 2016 that as he was concentrating bacteria and viruses, that he was creating a large amount of a waste byproduct. And that waste byproduct, fresh, clean water. What an epiphany, right? From that point, he began optimizing for this use case, building prototypes, proof of concepts. And today, he's at the point where we have a working prototype that's been tested in real-world environments. Here he is at a beach near Boston, deploying the device. There you go. He drank the water. He's still with us. He's right over here, I promise. So it's an amazing technology, and we're really excited with the progress so far. But I want to refocus for just a moment on the problem that we're solving. This is the trend. This is the frequency of natural disasters in recent years. It's a big problem. Currently, it's affecting 188 million people per year, and that's just the disasters that directly affect water supply, droughts, floods, and the like. It is a big problem, no doubt, and we believe we can make a difference. But just as water shortage affects us in many different ways, we believe that our solution can be applied in many different ways. Let's talk about a few of them. Our first products will be deployed after disaster strike. They will be small, durable, rugged. They are also ideal for soldiers in the military who are now carrying water on their backs on their missions. We can let them stay out longer and carry less weight. Sailors who go offshore on long trips, plenty of sun, plenty of sea, no fresh water source. I mentioned that there are 2 billion people on Earth today who lack reliable access to clean drinking water. A quarter of those, half billion people, are known to live near the coast in rural areas, far from those big desalination plants that I showed you. This is a perfect application for NONA, which works anywhere. Our friend Paul is one such person. He lives in Accra, Ghana. He can provide lower cost water to his family with NONA rather than relying on bottled water. He can also create jobs for entrepreneurs who want to operate these devices and distribute the water. In the home, we've talked to many who are building homes near the coast, have homes near the coast, or just some other source of salt water, and want to be secure in their water supply. And they don't have a good option today. So these first three use cases I've described, I think I can go back, constitute a scaling out of our technology. We also believe we can scale up to higher volume applications. One such application, farms. We've spoken to many farmers whose wells are turning salty. As the rain comes less often, farmers rely on groundwater, on their wells. And as you overuse a well, you overdrain an aquifer, they start to turn salty. It creates a low pressure zone that sucks in salt water from surrounding rock formations. They need a way to maintain food production. Desalination on site with NONA can be the answer. And it's lower cost than any existing alternative. Oil producers have a different kind of water problem. Oversupply. They have too much water. With hydraulic fracturing, for every one barrel of oil that comes out of the ground, 6 barrels of water come out of the ground. And it's mixed with oil, it's mixed with chemicals, and it's very salty. Today, it's handled often irresponsibly in a way that it's allowed to leach into groundwater from these open pools. With NONA, we can alleviate this environmental disaster, create a new water source for maybe a nearby farmer, and create another economic benefit for oil producers. Our vision is to create a more resilient society by increasing access to water. And we'll do this by allowing a shift from centralized water production, centralized desalination, to distributed desalination with this new innovative technology. NONA devices allow desalination to go from the plant to the small business, to the home, to the individual. We ultimately believe at NONA that there's no one solution to the world's water crisis. It's one of the biggest problems facing us. It's huge. We think the end solution is a collage of many different types of technologies with different attributes, combined with probably a more responsible use of water that we have access to. We believe NONA can fill some important gaps in this collage of technologies. Gaps, geographic gaps between these large desalination plants, gaps between the remote, the adventurers, and infrastructure, and ultimately the gap between thirst and hydration. We hope that we've inspired you with our drive to solve this problem. Please reach out to us if you're interested in joining our team or working with us in some way. I want to close by thanking LG for hosting us and for contributing to our shared vision to use technology to improve the world. It's a vision that we really care about. So much, in fact, that we're incorporated as a public benefit corporation, like Professor Chris mentioned. Thank you very much.